Hey everyone, welcome to Our Small Footprint. My name is Nyssa, and if you're new here, we are a family of eight who live off-grid in Australia. Today's video is a food prep, planning, preserving kind of video, which is my standard fare for the channel. I am over Easter and stuff, and with the construction of the new building, I'm standing in our, you know, construction zone at the moment, but it's got some really good light and it's raining and it's got a roof, so you know. And it's a little bit closer than the garden solar panels. You'll also probably get the chicken noise because the chicken pens are just behind me and the kids are out playing basketball, so you probably hear them too. So with Easter and the construction and everything, we got a little waylaid on our food prep videos for the March-April span from the groceries in March. So this is still dated in March at some point. I know we're in April, but this is just the next one. So this is part four, I think, for this, you know, grocery period supply run type thing. I'm still trying to figure out exactly the best way to run these videos, because this is the meat of my channel, I suppose, is these day in the life vlogs of my kitchen, because that's what is what I film the most and what everyone loves to watch, and seeing how I use all the food that we buy, what I make with it, and how I get it in the freezer or on the shelf and things like that. And I don't do a lot of like single item videos because I just don't really have the time to make in-depth videos about a single item. So I've been working on getting PDFs with lots of information and the website and stuff for the recipes, but most of the time these videos are a myriad of different things. So we're still working on, you know, the marketing of it and how it's going to work. But for the moment, we'll just stick with what we've been doing. So this is like part four of the March-April grocery period. So we're going for 7 to 8 weeks with this period, and we are having a few hiccups in the kids, I think the kids have just aged up a little bit, and with winter there, it's not as hot, so as it's not winter yet, but as they're coming into the cooler weather, they're moving around a lot more and they're eating a lot more and their portion sizes have increased. So I'm going to have to adapt, I think, with the next shop and figure that out. I actually had 3 Thermomix sales in March, which means that I get a nice little commission from that, and I think I'm going to use that to top up some of our meat stores and things like that, because that was unexpected income. That was because they have the 31 trade up at the moment. They actually have that on for the next week. It's till the 10th, I think. So if anyone's interested, reach out and I can help you out with any of that. They had the bowl blade extra set for $49 if you're just buying a 6, or they have the $250 off for trading up from a 31 plus a free bowl blade set. So just to put that in there. So yeah, that little bit of commission was unexpected income, not on my budget, so it's going to be surplus. So I might use that to stock up on some meat, because I find that we're just going through a bit more than we were. So the same ratios that I'm buying aren't quite stretching as much as I would like. We do have a lot of soups and stuff in summer, which use less meat because we can use lentils and we can use beans and all that sort of thing, potatoes and stuff like that. But at the same time, it's nice to have that extra meat in the freezer for whatever purpose that we want it. Anyway, that will be sort of discussed on the planning videos as well, when we figure out what the inventory is at the end of the period and things like that. We also have a hamper coming up, not this weekend, next weekend, and I was thinking I might buy 2 of them this month, and that might help just drag that food out a little bit further as well. So I will share that when I do that. I'm going to sort out payment for that this week and get that sorted too. We had a couple of trips into the IGA over the Easter as well. Darryl actually, they had, Foodworks actually had bananas for 99 cents a kilo, so we got 5 big bags of those, and we got plenty in the freezer, but for fresh eating. And IGA had 20 kilos of new season potatoes for $35, which isn't excessively cheap, but is a really good price for really nice new season potatoes. We bought those, so we'll pad out some meals with some roast potatoes and stuff this month too, so you'll see that coming ahead. But for the moment, this is part four. As I said, it's in March, it's before Easter, and some of this will cross over with some of the Easter videos too. I put little tiny snippets and just mentioned it so that you can see whereabouts it falls in the scope of, you know, timing and stuff. So I'll get into the voiceover and I will leave you with that. It's probably going to be a fairly lengthy video, this one, because it had the sausages in it and I wanted to get the whole process of the sausages in one video rather than skipping to the next day. So enjoy watching and I will see you at the end. Alrighty, we started off the day with some simple no-knead bread. This was a dough that I was making for something else the day before, and I didn't get around to shaping it, and it was just in a bowl, and it really needed to be used. So I just shaped it into a boulet, and I cooked it. It was a slightly enriched dough, so it's got a denser crumb, but a very soft, mildly sweet crumb. And I just wanted to make sure it got used. So as I said, I just, instead of it wasting it or anything else because it was a yeasted dough, I just shaped it into a rough round and cooked it off in the stove. One thing about one thing about baking bread the day before you eat it is that it's so easy to slice and get nice even slices, which is never as easy when it's fresh, but you know, you've got that toss up of fresh bread versus day old bread and cutting it, you know, it doesn't matter if it's a little bit rustic when it's fresh bread. We served it up with some bacon, fried eggs, mayo, caramelized onion, that sort of thing, just as a brunch that morning for eating. After that and whatever else I had started on, I started cooking the chicken. So this chicken was in the previous part video that I had marinated. So I'd put 3 containers of chicken in the fridge. 2 had our standard marinade, which was the cowboy candy, smoked paprika, garlic, salt, pepper, all that sort of thing. And 1 was in a buttermilk marinade, and they had gone in the fridge overnight, and this is the next day. So the standard one, I just started cooking off. So I cook it off in batches in the cast iron. I use a really nice high heat because we want to get some caramelization, some crunchiness on the external parts of the chicken, and we don't want to overcrowd the pan, because if we overcrowd it, it's going to stew in its own juices and it's not going to have that nice caramelization. So the aim is to have it sort of sparse in the pan, nice hot pan, cooked through. These are thighs, so they stay really nice and moist when you do this, and that cowboy candy and everything else helps too, because that caramelization, that holds some of the moisture into the pieces of chicken, which is really nice. We use this, once this is cooked, it gets frozen, and we use this in a lot of ways. It's nice in ramen, it's nice on flatbreads, it's nice in pasta dishes, in stir fries. You can use it any way you want, realistically. It's just pre-cooked chicken that goes in the freezer. I then mixed up some seasoned flour for the container of buttermilk chicken to be dredged in. So it's the same sort of spices as what's in the marinade, a fairly standard sort of blends of smoked paprika, garlic, onion. I still find it surprising that I lean on the same few spices. I have extras in there, but same few spices liberally, and yet everything has a different flavor with just really mild tweaks. I really enjoy that. The fact that I can buy like 6 spices in bulk and use them in a various different ways, and I have different tasting dishes but using the same bulk ingredients without having to have 30,000 spices. Now, I do have a lot of extra spices for things like butter chicken and curry paste and stuff like that, but I buy them in smaller amounts, obviously. But I like the fact that I can have these main sort of 5, you know, mustard powder, garlic powder, onion powder, smoked paprika, salt and pepper. That's 6. That's sort of the main ones, and I can still make such a wide variety of different tasting dishes out of it. When dredging in the flour mix, you want to bring lots of the marinade with you rather than letting it drip. This will cause that texture of the crumb, the flaky, feathery texture. Some people purposely add some marinade to the flour before dredging it, but I find that it just organically builds up to a nice quantity worth by not dripping or wiping off the chicken as you go. I do sometimes like scoop up some extra marinade with the chicken and plop it in the flour as well if I think it needs that extra texture. We cook this off in a few inches of oil. The oil discolors quite quickly with the buttermilk chicken because the dredge is a loose flour, and so you don't want to shake the dredge off too much because you're going for that flaky texture, and that means that there's lots of bits of flour that sort of burn in the oil. Now, the way I sort of approach this is that I cook it in bulk. So I cook, you know, this was probably 4 kilos of chicken all at once in the buttermilk. I marinate it overnight and then I dredge it and cook it all in one go in the one pot of oil. And then at the end of that, if the oil's really discolored and stuff, I just discard it. So you can strain it through like a coffee filter and things like that, but it's pretty heavily burnt at that point by doing all of that. So I find it easier to just do it all at once like that while the oil's nice and hot, it hasn't cooled and been reheated, rather than trying to use that oil multiple times over the span of the month. I just find it's easier to do it all at once, and then we can freeze the chicken, and because it's been deep fried, it heats up wonderfully. It's wonderful and crispy and moist, and the crumbs are really nice because it's got all that oil in it from being fried. You do find that the oil loses a lot of volume cooking something like this, because obviously the flour is sucking up a fair amount of that oil, which, you know, is super healthy but very tasty. So you might start with a fairly full pot. You also don't want to put too much oil in your pot to start with, because it will foam quite badly with this chicken. So you want to make sure that it's not going to overflow, especially with if you're using something like me, which is an open flame, because that would be bad. I just kept on going with all the chicken. I had to get done until it was all done. So this is what it looked like when all the chicken was done. As the buttermilk chicken's cooking, I put it on a rack over a tray so that it can drip off any excess oil. But the grilled stuff I put in a closed tray so that all the juices end up in that tray. And then when I freeze it, I actually mix it through those juices so it has a nice even amount of flavor with each bag of chicken as well. And that keeps it nice and moist too. After I was through with that and it was all put away, I started on some of the plums that we got in the hamper. Now, I got multiple trays of plums, and it was a tiny bit of poor timing because it was the same weekend that I came home with groceries. So I didn't get as much done as quickly as I would have liked, and I couldn't be as creative. There was a cake that was suggested that I really wanted to make and things like that, but I just needed to get them processed. Maybe I'll get more plums in this season. There's still plum season available to me, so I might get some more this season anyway. So one of the easiest things to start out with any fruit that you need to do in bulk is to puree it. I washed the plums and then took a heap to the bench. I pitted them, which wasn't as hard as I actually expected. Pitting some stone fruit is horrible. I did end up with some little cuts on my thumb from you know, levering out the pits, but they were fairly easy to pit, which was really nice. As I cut them, I started filling a Thermomix jug with the fruit and pureeing it, and then measuring out how many cups it was of puree into a pot. I still don't think at this point I had truly decided exactly what I was going to be doing with it, but jam was definitely a possibility. By about 5:30 and time to get dinner and baths and stuff done, I had a full pot of puree. Now, I left all the skins and everything on. We want that flavor, that color, and the nutrients in the skins. And I didn't push the puree too far because I knew I'd have to leave the pot overnight in the fridge before I could get to it. So in that overnight soak, all the acid and stuff in the fruit will break down that skin even more. The color will change. It will be a lot darker rather than pink. It'll be more of a plum color. And those skins will sort of dissolve more when it's cooked as well. So I left it like that in the pot, put it in the fridge overnight. So the next day, as you can see, it has that darker plum color. As the skins have dissolved a bit, they've colored the rest of the flesh and the acid has broken them down a little bit. Now I use a low methylester pectin, which is the same as Pomona's pectin, but I buy it in bulk from Green Living Australia. And I put the pectin into the sugar for, like, mix the relevant quantity of sugar to the pectin, because that's how you disperse the pectin into the jam. It uses added calcium water to help with setting rather than the large quantities of sugar, and most recipes you can use about a quarter to a half of the amount of sugar as a standard jam. It depends on the fruit. Pomona's Pectin has a website, and that's generally what I do. I just search Pomona's Pectin and jam. They have a chart that you can download, and it actually has where you can make your own, so it tells you like how many cups of puree to how many teaspoons of calcium water and how much pectin is required, minimum amounts of sugar to maximum amount of sugar and all that sort of thing, and you can just make your own up from there. I do have the chart, and at some point I'd like to put it in a book or something somewhere to have in my kitchen, but at the moment with the kitchen the way it is, I don't have it there, so I tend to just check on my phone. I decided I wanted to avoid a very sticky mess, so I transferred the puree to a larger pot before getting started because it just ended up being too full in that pot. I added the relevant amount of bottled lemon juice. Now, I think I didn't write it down, but I think I ended up with 32 cups of puree, so that's what I was basing it on, the bottled lemon juice and the calcium water, and brought it up to a boil. After that, I started adding the sugar and pectin mix, stirring vigorously as I went to make sure that the pectin disperses through the jam. Otherwise, you can get little chunks of like jellied bits of fruit in there. I added it in sort of three or four different lots to make it easier to mix, and I grated up to my super large whisk after getting splattered with hot jam for quite a few times. Now, there's some debate about getting jam to set in larger batches. I definitely find it an issue in standard jams when you're just relying on either the sugar or a standard pectin. But with the low methylester pectin, I don't find it an issue. I also don't really have a problem if my jams don't set up perfectly well. The kids will eat them regardless. They're not fussy. I'm not giving them away. I'm not selling them or anything like that. So I just sized up to the amount of puree that I had there, and it seems to work well. So long as you disperse that pectin through the sugar well and you add it in vigorously and things like that, I've never had a problem with it. So once all that sugar is in there, you want to bring it back up to the boil for a couple of minutes before turning it off. I ladled this into the 300ml jars that I recently bought. I got these from iWoohoo, and I think they were like a dollar each, which is really cheap for jars. The shipping was really reasonable as well. Their lids were really cheap too. So I bought like 240 of the 63ml lids and the 82ml lids anyway, and then bought the jars too. So it worked out quite a good price. I like that they use the same size lid as my ghee jars, or a 1 liter jar as well, because I used that a lot and I reused those lids a real lot as well. I may end up going back and getting some more of these jars because I do like the size. I used to not really do much in the way of processing jam. I just bought a couple of jars each shopping trip. But I do love the idea that I can do low sugar jam with fruit that is somewhat free. Like these trays of plums were a gold coin donation, so they were next to free. I think I used a 2 kilo bag of sugar for the whole thing, which is like $3, and then the pectin and stuff as well, which is not cheap. I buy it in bulk, and I think it's a 250 gram pack of pectin, and I think it might be $60 for that, but you can make a lot out of that. I haven't found it cheaper anywhere else than Green Living Australia either. And the kids these days do go through a lot of jam. Like, they really like things like rice cakes with peanut butter and jam on them, which they eat a lot as a snack, or some sort of a nut butter and a jam, depending on what I've got. And they could easily go through one of these jars in a day between the six of them, only having, you know, 3 rice cakes each or something like that. It goes through pretty fast. So being able to make it in bulk like this is definitely handy. I cleaned all the rims with white vinegar, making sure that there was no sticky bits of sugar or fruit on the rims that will interfere with the sealing of the jars. The lids were washed as well, and I tend to run the vinegar cloth around the inside of the lid as well. Sonnet wanted to help, so while she did that, I started getting the canner ready. I put 3 quarts of water in the bottom of the pressure canner, which I'm going to use as a steam canner, and a rack, and then started stacking the jars in the canner. Now, I have some perforated pizza trays that I use as racks in between. They fit perfectly in the buffalo canner. I do have a couple of standard racks, which is what I've used in the bottom. They come with the presto, but the buffalo is slightly wider. These pizza trays do not fit in the presto, but they do fit in the buffalo. So I did 3 full layers of jam, which is really neat. It's a full can load of jam, all those plums used nice and quickly, and it's low sugar, and the kids will enjoy it, and I'm pretty happy with this sort of event. It was fairly simple to do too. As I said, I used the pressure canner to steam can them. I brought the canner up to a steady stream of steam. Once the valve lifted, I started the timer for 15 minutes, then turned it off and let the valve drop again before opening. The next thing I started working on was some rolls for dinner, also testing out ratios for recipes just to get them how I want. While I was mixing that up, you can see on the other side of the bench that Darryl was cubing up the pork for me. So we bought lots of pork roast this month, and we needed to get them sorted as well. So while I was doing the dough and the other stuff, Darryl took the rind off the roasts and cut them all into cubes for the mincer. He also cut one roast just into 2 roast pieces. One of them we coated with my standard I don't seem to have any footage. It must have been because we were working at the same time and he was doing it for me. But I put a layer of Dijon mustard on the pork, and then I use the pork rub that I have, which is a blend of spices and brown sugar and stuff, and that creates a really nice crust. Once the burger dough had proofed, I started dividing it, aiming here for like flatter rolls than my normal. So less on a tray, I want them to spread out a little bit, but I also want to reduce the dough per bun because everyone likes to have 2 buns in a meal. So if I can get the buns at a slightly lower grammage and spread out more toppings to bread is a good thing. This dough ended up being quite wet. The day was quite warm and overproofed a touch, but I made it work. So I used 80 gram balls, I think 75 to 80 gram balls instead of my usual 90 grams to see how it fared. I put them on the wider baking trays rather than my cast iron roasters. Now there's pros and cons to that. The cast iron roasters I can fit 2 of in the barbecue. These big trays I can only fit 1 of. But I wanted them to spread out to be more like flat hamburger rolls than the higher sort of like dinner roll style thing. I brushed them with an egg mixed with a bit of water and sprinkled them with everything but the bagel seasoning mix, because I just happened to have a jar of it mixed up already and I really like it. And if they don't want it, they can, you know, get rid of it. The other thing we were getting done was juicing lemons and limes. So Kavik had asked to do some of the lemons for me, so I set him up on the other side of the bench with the juicer, and I peeled and zested the lemons, then cut them in half for him to juice for me. Once the pork hit temperature, it's about 64 Celsius or 145 Fahrenheit, which is rare for pork because you are allowed to eat pork rare because it is classed as a red meat. And I highly recommend trying it if you haven't, because when you do a roast like this, we normally do it in the smoker, but the smoker's not working. But when you do a roast like this with that rub to that temperature, it just melts in your mouth. It's really, really good. The buns I kept rotating in and out of the barbecue as needed to cook them all off, because as I said, on those baking trays, I can only fit one tray at a time in there, though I could fit that roast tray and a tray of buns. But the temperature doesn't rotate, doesn't circulate very well, because that was like filling up the whole tray. So you're better off having gaps between them, which is why one of those trays works better than having those two in there. I also worked on some of the lemons. So I did some preserved lemons, which is whole lemons in salt. I scrubbed the skins with a bit of bicarb. Then I sliced the knobbly bits off each end of the lemon, cut them into quarters, but not all the way through, and put a spoon of salt in the middle, squishing them into a jar. Then kept on going. I used my wooden rolling pin as a tamper. I do need to get a new sauerkraut tamper. I should add that to my shopping list. But the rolling pin worked for the moment. It just doesn't have as wide a surface area, which the tampers have, which is nice. So I kept on rotating between lemons and salt, squishing them all in there. The aim is that there will be enough lemon juice to cover all the solids. If there isn't, you can add a bit in there from extra lemons if needed. And then I cap it off and leave it on the bench for a few days to get all that juice out and soak everything. And then I'll store it in the fridge. Preserved lemons are used in a lot of Mediterranean dishes. I know that there's a lot of tagine dishes that have them in there, and they're really nice sliced up in those dishes. They add some immense flavor. I do really like them stuffed in a whole roast chicken as well, like in the cavity of the chicken. I normally put some sort of citrus, but the preserved lemons work really well too. Lots of flavor in there, and you can eat them, slice them up and eat them with the chicken afterwards. They're so soft and just, yeah, super tasty. So I like to have a jar of preserved lemons in the fridge at all times if I can, though we are, you know, certain amount of fridge space used for things, and I do store it in the fridge. I think you can probably store it on a shelf, but not in my temperatures. It's just too hard. After that, I got all the jars of jam out of the canner and put them on a board, and they'll rest for the 24 hours before they get the seals tested and they get put onto the pantry shelves. The next task was to get all that pork that Darryl had cubed minced up so we could season it for the sausages. We had put the cubes in the freezer while we got other stuff done, because that extra chilling makes it go through the mincer a whole lot easier, and Darryl just worked through it for me. So he used my Louvel mincer. I rave about this every time I show it. I really enjoy the mincer. It has low power usage. It just powers through. It does around about a kilo of meat in a minute. Is what I've worked out by watching some of the timing on the videos, which is plenty fast enough for us with the low power usage, and we're happy to just chug through it. We do try not to mince too much meat in summer because the flies can be really bad. It's definitely better to do it in winter or the colder weather, and we do need to try and time some of that appropriately. All these pork was really cheap, so we didn't have much choice about timing for this, but if we do bulk sausages and things like that, it's definitely better to do it in the cooler weather than the hotter weather. So while he was mincing that, I was taking portions of it to season, and some was going in the fridge, and we were just rotating it out. Now, I use a chart as a base. It has like standardized amounts of spices per kilo or pound in a sausage mix. I find some of these amounts are far too little flavor for us, and I think there's going to definitely be personal preference in a lot of this. I will try and remember to put the link to the chart in the comments though, so that you can have a look at it. So I use the 2% salt, which is pretty standard, 1 to 2% salt. We like the 2%. I use about 150 grams, like half a jar of my cowboy candy brine per about 5 kilos of meat. I tend to be generous with my smoked paprika. I reckon there was about 50 grams of that, about 20 grams of mustard powder, a really healthy glug of Worcestershire sauce, 20 odd grams of garlic powder. You would use more weight if you were using like minced garlic or fresh garlic, but powder you use less weight, obviously, and 10 to 20 grams of cracked black pepper. Now it depends on how heavy you want that pepper flavor. We have bumped that quite a lot and done like cracked black pepper Worcestershire flavored sausages. This is a very, for us, a very generic sort of a flavor profile, similar to a lot of things that we eat, and sometimes when we make sausages, we make like 4 different flavored batches, but we're getting it done this time and getting them in the freezer using all the same flavor, all the same standardized spices and stuff that we like to have with this. And then you just want to blend and emulsify it well with your hand. It's going to go through a tube to go into the sausages, but you want to get it to that almost stringy texture that they talk about with sausages. When you blend it with your hands, it creates a bit more of a stringy sort of a texture, which is the meat emulsifying and holding together. If you don't do this, if you just mince it rough into your sausage casings, it tastes fine, but when you cut your sausages open, the meat tends to fall out. It doesn't have that sausage type texture. I did end up cooking a patty of the meat up to test the flavoring as well. I just took a chunk out of the parts that I had marinated and cooked it off in the fry pan just so that we could taste it. It's always a little bit saltier initially than after the 24 hours of sitting in the fridge and after it goes into the sausage casings. We find that it's one of those things that the flavor is a bit stronger initially, but once you get it in the sausage casings, it's toned down. A little bit like when things are frozen, I always talk about how the smoothie pops, you want to make them more flavorful than you expect, because once you freeze them, their flavors tone down. It's a similar sort of thing. I'm not sure exactly the science behind it, but it just is. There are so many variations of flavor you can make, and we, as I said, we could have done multiple versions, but we ended up just doing the basic one in bulk to get it all done and, you know, processed. Once it was all blended, it went back into the fridge to marinate overnight. I showed this clip in the vacuum sealer video, but just as a, this is what we did in order sort of thing. We bagged up all that buttermilk chicken and grilled chicken that had been refrigerated. So this is cold. You have to, if you're using the chamber vacuum sealer, the items have to be cold. They cannot be warm. So we bagged up all the buttermilk chicken and the grilled chicken into bags and vacuum sealed them up for the freezer. I have, as I said earlier in the intro of the video, I have noticed that I need to bag these up in larger sizes lately. As the kids have gotten older, the portions have needed to obviously grow, and we are definitely using more in a meal than we were. I also decided I don't really think I like the buttermilk chicken in the vacuum sealer, the chamber vacuum sealer. I prefer it in the Ziploc bag, so it's all separated. It takes up more room, but it's easier to reheat, and it's not a long-term storage option for us. Like, we tend to make it once at the beginning of each shopping cycle and use it all in that month. So it doesn't need vacuum sealing, really, because it's not going to be a long-term storage item in our freezer. This is what the pork roast looked like when we sliced it and what the buns looked like after being cooked. So for dinner that night, we went really simple and just had the roast pork and gravy on rolls for dinner. The next day we got the sausages sorted. So I buy my casings from the casing boutique. I got the 28 to 30 mil hog casings and I got the 45 meters of them, which is around about $50 including post. I soaked them for the morning before using, ran water through them to flush any salt because they come packed in salt. Threaded them onto the sausage filler attachment on the Louvel. Now, the Louvel works wonderfully as a sausage stuffer, but it's not my favorite way to stuff sausages. I much prefer the upright manual, or you can get powered ones. We haven't tried a powered one. 5 kilo stuffers. Ours blew a seal though, and we haven't been able to get a replacement, and I haven't troubleshooted or bought a replacement as yet. The Louvel works perfectly. It's just a harder job to get the tempo and the rhythm right when you're having to transfer and shove the mince through the tube in smaller amounts. Whereas in the manual one, you fill the chamber with 5 kilos of mince and you run that all through the sausage casing. So it's like a whole string of sausages all in one go. Darryl pushed the meat through while I maintained the tension on the skins. You need to sort of push back a little to get them full enough, but not so much that when you go to twist them, they burst. There's a little bit of a learning curve on how full you want the cases to be and the right size spout to get that tension correct and the quantity within the skins right and things like that. It's not hard, but it's something that I've figured out what works for us over the time of making the sausages. I still had some thick and thin spots throughout just due to the whole process, as I said, of small amounts going into the grinder and being pushed through into the sausage cases in spits and spats. We would fill a length of casing and then I would twist them. Now, I really need to research the proper method of doing this, but I always forget to do it before we're right in the moment. So I just do it. I do approximately the same lengths by eye, twist one sausage towards you and then the next one away from you, and that's going to keep on twisting them. If you twist them all in the same direction, the previous one that you've twisted is going to come unraveled. As you go through the string of sausages, you adjust the positioning of the meat as you need to. You will have some thinner parts of casing versus some thicker ones. To get a nice even thickness through, you just sort of manipulate it within the casing, unless you're, you know, really good at it, which I am obviously not. Once it's all twisted up, I put them on racks over trays to go in the fridge. This allows the skins to sort of set a little bit before you bag them to freeze. I do have a sausage pricker too, if needed, which will pierce any big bubbles on the skin and allow it to suction back to the sausages. You're supposed to have them not touching when you do this sort of cure, but we had a very full fridge and no way to spread them out any further, and it works fine. The next day, as seen in the vacuum sealer video as well, we vacuum sealed them up into portions. Now, we got, I think it was 15 bags of 12 sausages and 9 bags of 6, plus the excess that I kept out that were a little odd-sized and that sort of thing that we ate for dinner that night. I worked out that each sausage was about 80 grams each, 85 grams each, so about 20 kilos of pork, which works out about right. So there was 4 roasts that were approximately 7 kilos each. We lost some weight removing the rind, as well as just general loss in water while they cure and that sort of thing. So 20 kilos of sausages cost us around about the $232 mark, which is approximately $11.60 a kilo for them. That's including the casings and everything else as well, which isn't cheap as such, but the cheapest sausages, like I went looking at prices for sausages, and the cheapest sausages, let's look at, say, Coles for a start. They have the cheap barbecue sausages. They're about $6.67 a kilo, so long as you buy the big 2-kilo pack. They're only about 70% meat, and the rest is filler, which is fine. A lot of sausages have filler in them. They're a cheap meal. That's sort of how they make them cheap. It has rice flour and all that sort of stuff in it. But that's a fairly flavorless basic sausage for $6.67 a kilo. I had a look and they're a combination of predominantly beef with a bit of chicken. I didn't know that, but that's what they are. The next step up are their like original beef, plain pork, chicken, sage and thyme, that sort of sausages. They run at about 75% meat and they're $12 a kilo. Then they have their Coles Finest range, which are about 80%, 78-80% of meat, and they run at about $16 a kilo. I also looked at some butcher pricing for gourmet sausages, which to me I think is more where my homemade ones sit, and that was a bit of a rabbit hole of flavours, mind you, and I'm going to get some inspiration for those when I decide to do some more significant sausages again. And we have made lots of flavours before. We've done like we've used mushrooms powdered in them and things like that, but and caramelised onion and all that sort of stuff, but we just didn't this time. But they run it anywhere from about $16 to $23 a kilo from what I could see, depending on where you're buying from, the quality of the ingredients, the flavours and how gourmet they are. So I'm okay with the pricing. I know add in our time and some of the extra ingredients like, you know, the cowboy candy and the spices and stuff like that will kick it up a little bit higher than the $11.60 a kilo, but I'm okay with that. The time I'm happy to spend, and I don't really count my time in most of what I do because it's a choice. The time, adding that time in is a choice. So I'm okay with the cost of them and what it ended up being. And I just broke it down purely for interest sake. I would have done it regardless. I think even if the pricing ended up quite high, I'd still do it. But I thought it was interesting and I thought you might find it interesting as well. So we have a freezer full of sausages, which is fantastic. And we have a shelf with pom jam and, you know, all these sorts of things. So anyway, thank you for joining me again and I hope you enjoyed watching and I will see you on the next video. Bye, guys.